Hey, this is Juliet, and a lot of people ask about how to get the most out of your brushes. I'm still trying to figure that out when it comes to landscaping, but I can definitely show you the portrait part of it. How I get the most out of the brushes, these brushes, how they work with portraits. I can definitely tell you about that one. When I am doing portraits, I always do the bottom layer as a background. Usually don't do it this way, but we'll do it this way for this one. Actually, no, I will show you how to do it first. Okay, so we go up here to layer number four, which is what I call the sketch layer. And we're just going to do a basic shape of a person. Just so I can show you how the brushes work. Okay, so let's say this is our person, right? Oh, and here's our hairline. Right, so that's on our fourth layer, which I wish they would put sketch layer instead of layer four. And then this is usually the person or objects, and then our background. So with our background, I usually don't do first. I usually do the person, then the background. But I want to show you how this brush works. This is usually what Bob Ross mainly uses. It doesn't work that way in here, unfortunately. So, I'm still on my landscaping palette, excuse me. Let me go over to my person number one palette. Because I have two skin tone palettes. Okay. So, this brush is only good for putting down big, large bodies of paint. It's not good for blending. And I hardly use it other than doing the backgrounds. If you do the background first before you do your person, you're not going to see the outline of the person, which is why I don't do the background first. But I want to start from left to right showing you the brushes is why I'm doing it now. So I'm going to have to lighten up the area that the person's going to be in so we can see our outlines. Some people do the skin tone and the outline on the same layer, and you can do that too. We need to add some color now. We're just going to put a lot of splotches. And you see how it didn't blend at all? This one I use for blending that. Put it on my biggest setting. There we go. And we will just ah. arm cramped. You will find if you play Vermillion, it'll wear your arm out. And also, you will run out of batteries more. Now, you can keep it kind of sketchy like that, or you can come back through and kind of soften your lines. Okay, so that's what this is for. Large body of paint. Okay, this one I'll do later. This one is perfect for hair. And I'll quickly, you can do it as a regular brush. Actually, let me do actual skin tone. Oh no. Okay. You can do it as a regular brush. I don't. I go to bristle because you can switch it from smooth to bristle. And it kind of gives these lines. You see all the little individual little lines for hair? So it does real good hair. So that's what I use for hair. And you already saw me use this for a brief second. This is your blender brush. You can go thick or thin. I use thin for the going around the outlines. And thick for like softening the backgrounds and certain areas on the face. You can also soften the hair, but if you soften the hair, you will want to go with the paint, not against the paint. See how it changed it? So that's a good hair technique. This one, let's say you got paint a little bit further away out from where you wanted it. This is supposed to be a mover to move the paint around. Like if I went outside my outline, I could just push the paint back in. I don't ever really use that one, but that's what this is for. Just moving the paint. See how I just move the paints like a scraper? You're scraping the paint. Easy for fixing mistakes. And of course, if you make a mistake, you can go and erase it. But let's hope you never have to do that if you've gone pretty far. Usually when I do my outline, if you haven't dipped it in the bucket for the first time in your painting, you can soften your outlines. Maybe just dip it once. Soften them so that you can see through the line. Kind of makes it semi-transparent. Okay. This one here, if you're doing, where's my good base at? We'll do that as a base. I gotta rearrange that. Let's say we don't want to use that one, we want to use this one, and we want to put down it's just a smaller brush we're going to put down our base with. Okay. So there's that one. Don't know why my hand's wigging out, but there we go. Ever since I did that main update for Quest, my games have been so wonky. There we go. This one kind of gives lines as well. You could do like your thicker group of hair with it. And then go back and, oop, I wanted that one. And do your hair as well. But I really prefer that one for hair. And here's the fan brush. This one's really, really good for hair, but only if you do it as a bristle. So here's bristle going down. What can I do for the hair color? We'll do that one again. Okay. This is like a smaller version of that one. Now this brush would be good for like highlights. Let's say we had our hair like we wanted it. We had this layer right here. We needed extra highlights. Like the light's hitting it just right. Let me fix that. So when you're doing hair streaks, you want to like gently dab it and pull. And then we're going to go back and soften it for your highlights. This one I hardly never use, but now I'm starting to use it. Make sure it's very well saturated. And then if you had a strand of hair, or strand, second strand, you could do your strands with that. I'll take that back off. This one is only used for like straight lines. I use it for straight lines. I think it's better for straight lines. I mean, you could use your rigger brush. I don't really see the point of using that for a portrait. Unless you did it like that. Yeah, so I don't ever use that for portraits. This brush, when I first started Vermillion, I used this for everything. Everything, I'm telling you. But, this is a dark brownish color, skin tone color. But it's made with blue, so I consider this the blue family, which is perfect for shading. And then we'll go around the eyes, because there's always shading around the eyes. Usually around the tip of the nose, under the bottom lip. If the hair comes down over the hair, and we'll just do it like that. Okay. So that was used just to put the color down. And then this makes a good blender as well. It doesn't make it overly soft like that one, which is why it's preferred for me, and a lot of people prefer it over the blender brush. So we're going to take the same brush and just blend that out and make soften it a little bit. Same with, I know this doesn't look peachy, but I promise you this one will go down peachy. Then we'll do highlights. And then we'll soften that up a little bit. As light hits, you want to add a little bit of yellow on the top part. Blend that out. We need to add some red up in there, or pink, because your cheeks get kind of flushed. Sometimes the forehead is flushed. And then blend that in. And that's basically how that brush works. There is a bristle as well. Oh, let me get some color so we can see the difference. And it also makes a good hair brush as well to do hair. And again, going with the way it's painted. And this is the rigger brush. When you have, let me delete some of this. Oh no, wrong layer. Okay. When we have fully deleted our lines, because some people like to keep outlines, some people like to color their outlines, which is what we're going to do. See how you can see the brush strokes where one ends and one begins? We want to soften that, but we also want to separate. So we're going to separate with the outline. You do that with this. And then we're going to come back, thin out our blender brush. Oh, wrong layer. Make sure you keep up with your layers so that you get your paint on the right one. Sometimes I forget, but thank goodness we have a undo. There we go. And we're just going to soften the outline a little bit. We're going to take this brush back. Add some highlights to the shoulder and maybe the chest. I'm not going to use the blender brush on this one. Now, sometimes, depending on how soft you want the skin, you can do that, but I think it makes the person look extra small, extra soft. And I don't really go with that. See how it looks extra soft now? Then we're going to use the rigger brush. Go over that. Come back to that layer and soften our outline. Okay. Now let's say I don't ever use the knife on a portrait. Now if you wanted texture, you could, but that would be the only reason. Let's say we did this. If you wanted extra thick painting, You wouldn't get any mixing in though. And then some highlights. I just don't like that. And if you go to print out your picture, if you, because this is all digital, if you go to print out your picture, it doesn't translate well half the time. But you'll see where the dark shines through. It just depends on the style that you're doing. As far as the hair goes, if I go back to this brush, because I use this for everything, we're just going to slap some hair on real quick. We want to soften it so that the lines aren't as harsh. Don't want too much hard lines. Okay. Because we're going to go through here. Actually, I'll use this one. Oh, this one. Okay. Make sure I'm on bristle. And of course, if you're doing dark roots, you would add dark before you start adding these line layers. And there's no real wrong way of doing how many layers you do. We're just gonna try and get her dirty blonde. Okay. And we will soften the hair. If you don't, it will look too harsh because it is a painting and you don't want each individual strand. So that is how I do the hair. Okay. And remember our highlights. That wasn't a very good angle to do this at, but that's okay. Okay. I hope this has been very beneficial to someone out there watching. And your rigor. For eyebrows. And then you'll want to go with the lightest gray you can get to do the eyes, because eyes aren't always white. I mean, they're off-white. So you'll do that here and then do that. My name is Juliet. If you happen to run into me or would like to get with me, I can give you my skin tone palette. I will be rearranging it though for the yellow highlights on top, and then I'm going to put my mid-tones and then the bluish colors like that. This one here. And then the reds, I'll put the reds together. And then you can get a copy of my palette. I have more of a different palette that's kind of set up like that. My mid-tones, my yellows, my reds, and my blues. Okay.